is God's will. December, he's going to do some kind of test. Yes. But I'm not coming. Wish I didn't have done it. I had to.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to worship here with us at St. Philip. Whether you're here in person or worshiping with us online, welcome to worship. Those of you that aren't here for the 10:30 service, maybe who have come to 10:30 in the past, but that we are still streaming it using the phone and all that stuff. So there might be a little bit of lulls kind of in worship as I'm moving things so that the people at home can kind of still hear and see things that are going on. Hopefully it doesn't disrupt anybody's worship too much. A few other announcements about this community of faith. We will have a new member class for those interested in joining with us. Those will happen on November 22nd and December 6th. Between the worship services at 9:45 down in the fellowship hall where we can still kind of sit spaced out. Also this morning at 9:45 we had our annual meeting of the congregation. Minutes will be out in the next newsletter and things like that if you're curious about what all went on there. Mostly it was just electing council members for the next years and approving the budget. Today also we will have communion. If you are here last week, you've heard this announcement, but if you weren't here last week, we did get new communion kit packets that are a little bit different than the ones we had before. The wafers are easier to get into, the wine is a little bit harder. So it's not wine, it's grape juice. Just take your time getting into that packet, Arthur will place love, like I said. We'll have lots of time. For those of you that do come through for drive-through communion, please remember the change. That drive-through communion is happening just on the first Sundays of the month, so there won't be drive-through communion today. Then also today we have a special music and prayers for Veterans Day as we remember those who have served in our military. Thanks to Jim for coming in and playing the trumpet for us today. Now let's take a moment of silence before we continue on with worship. Let us continue worship using the Veterans Day litany. O Lord, open our lips.
And our mouths shall proclaim your praise.
Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, we give you thanks for the men and women who have served and defended our country, and the values of freedom and justice we hold so dear. Help us be mindful of the sacrifices they made, and the hardship endured by their families and friends, so that we never take for granted the privileges they have secured for us. Hear us, we pray, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
Thank you.
Almighty and everlasting God, whose providence guides your people in diligent service, bless the officers and enlisted men and men of the Army, Navy, Marines, Air Force, and Coast Guard as they perform the duties of their calling. Give them not only true love of country, but also love of you and an understanding of your love for all people, so that relying upon your guidance, they may courageously defend our nation from every foe, promote justice, honor, and unity among our people, and be a means of fostering mutual respect and understanding among all peoples of the world. Through Jesus Christ, your Son and our Lord.
Amen. Eternal protector of the helpless, hear the cry of the distressed, and grant speedy deliverance in a new day of peace and concord.
Amen.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Eternal God, we give thanks for all those who have shown the greatest love by laying down their lives for others. We especially thank you for those in our military throughout history who have sacrificed their lives for their fellow citizens and for us who came after. As we remember their service, keep us mindful of all those for whom this day is a burden, and send your spirit of comfort to them. Be present with all the women and men who are serving in the military today. Let them live for the peace known only from you. Help us to be worthy of their legacy and to keep us mindful of their service, that in all things we may live our lives in praise and thanksgiving to you. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
God, grant peace among nations. Cleanse from our own hearts the seeds of strife, grief and envy, harsh misunderstandings and ill will, fear and the desire for revenge. Make us quick to welcome adventures and cooperation among the peoples of the world, so that there may be woven the fabric of a common good too strong to be torn by the evil hands of war. Lead us from death to life, from falsehood to truth. Lead us from despair to hope, from fear to trust. Lead us from hate to love, from war to peace, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
reading from Jonah. Now the word of the Lord came to Jonah, son of Amittai, saying, "Go at once to Nineveh, that great city, and cry out against it, for their wickedness has come up before me." But Jonah set to flee out to Tarshish from the presence of the Lord. He went down to Joppa and found a ship going to Tarshish. So he paid his fare and went on board to go with them to Tarshish away from the presence of the Lord. But the Lord hurled a great wind upon the sea, and such a mighty storm came upon the sea that the ship threatened to break up. Then the mariners were afraid, and each cried to his God. They threw the cargo that was in the ship into the sea to lighten it for them. Jonah, meanwhile, had gone down to the hold of the ship and had lain down and was fast asleep. The captain came and said to him, "What are you doing sound asleep? Get up, call on your God. Perhaps the God will spare us a thought so that we do not perish." The sailors said to one another, "Come, let us cast lots so that we may know on whose account this calamity has come upon us." So they cast lots, and the lot fell on Jonah. Then they said to him, "Tell us why this calamity has come upon us. What is your occupation? Where do you come from? What is your country, and of what people are you?" "I am a Hebrew," he replied. "I worship the Lord, the God of heaven, who made the sea and the dry land." Then the men were even more afraid and said to him, "What is this that you have done?" For the men knew that he was fleeing from the presence of the Lord because he had told them so. Then they said to him, "What shall we do to you so that the sea may be quiet down for us?" So the sea was growing more and more tempestuous. He said to them, "Pick me up and throw me into the sea. Then the sea will quiet down for you. For I know that it is because of me that this great storm has come upon you." Nevertheless, the men rowed hard to bring the ship back to land, but they could not, for the sea grew more and more stormy against them. Then they cried out to the Lord, "Please, O Lord, we pray, do not let us perish on account of this man's life. Do not make us guilty of innocent blood. For you, O Lord, have done as it pleased you." So they picked Jonah up and threw him into the sea, and the sea ceased from its raging. Then the men feared the Lord even more, and they offered up a sacrifice to the Lord and made vows. But the Lord provided a large fish to swallow up Jonah, and Jonah was in the belly of the fish 3 days and 3 nights. The word of the Lord came to Jonah a second time, saying, "Get up, go to Nineveh, that great city, and proclaim to it the message that I tell you." So Jonah set out and went to Nineveh according to the word of the Lord. Now Nineveh was an exceedingly large city, a 3 days walk across. Jonah began to go into the city, going a day's walk. He cried out, 40 days more, and Nineveh shall be overthrown." And the people of Nineveh believed God. They proclaimed a fast, and everyone, great and small, put on sackcloth. When the news reached the king of Nineveh, he rose from his throne, removed his robe, covered himself with sackcloth, and sat in ashes. Then he had a proclamation made in Nineveh. "By the decree of the king and his nobles, no human being or animal, no herd or flock shall taste anything. They shall not feed, nor shall they drink water. Human beings and animals shall be covered with sackcloth, and they shall cry mightily to God. All shall turn from their evil ways and from the violence that is in their hands. Who knows? God may relent and change his mind. He may turn from his fierce anger so that we do not perish." When God saw what they did, how they turned from their evil ways, God changed his mind about the calamity that he said he would bring upon them, and he did not do it. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
According to Luke.
who trusted in themselves that they were righteous and regarded others with contempt. Two men went out to the temple to pray, one a Pharisee and the other a tax collector. The Pharisee, standing by himself, was praying thus, God, I thank you that I am not like other people, thieves, rogues, adulterers, or even like this tax collector. I fast twice a week. I give a tenth of all my income. But the tax collector, standing far off, would not even look up to heaven, but was beating his breast and saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. I tell you, this man went down to his home justified rather than the other. For all who exalt themselves will be humbled, but all who humble themselves will be exalted. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
What a year this week has been. This week, many of you may have wanted to run away like Jonah. Just get away from it all. And while that is a cute idea that we pull from this story, there's actually a little bit more here than simply wanting to run away. There's something that maybe hits even a little bit closer to home. It's the us versus them mentality. We may not see it on the surface, but dig just a little bit into the history of the Hebrews and the Ninevites, and we see that this story has loads of lines drawn, teams chosen, and you are with us or you are against us mentality. On the one hand, we have Jonah, the Hebrew, the good guy. He's one of us. Yay, Jonah! On the other hand, there is everyone else. The Ninevites and the sailors, they are the bad guys, the ones that we see as antagonists. And these two sides, well, they pretty much hate each other. Boo everyone else. So we hear this story and we pick our side. Jonah is one of us, everyone else is one of them. Jonah is God's prophet. Everyone else doesn't go to church. Jonah, good. Everyone else, bad. Jonah is our God. Even though Jonah is the worst person in the story. Now hear me out. First, he doesn't go to Nineveh, as God tells him to. Remember, Jonah hates those people, and he doesn't want anything good to happen for them, including hearing about a gracious God. So instead, he boards a ship and heads towards Tarshish, the opposite direction. And then, while on that boat, all the sailors are praying during the storm, and yet Jonah hides out in the bottom of the ship, not praying. When Jonah finally ends up in Nineveh, that whole big fish incident, he only goes a little way in and gives an 8-word sermon to try to get the Ninevites to change their ways. Not a very good effort there, Jonah. In terms of prophet performance, that is pretty putrid. And yet we like Jonah. Sure, he's got a little room to grow as a prophet, a little rough around the edges, but he's on our side, so that's good enough for us. Besides, have you seen what those Ninevites were doing? And those sailors, you know how they run their mouths. The Ninevites, they're all mixed up in this funny business. But because Jonah is one of us, we tend to give him the benefit of the doubt. And because everyone else is one of them, they should burn in hell. Now, I've racked my brain, thinking of some way to bring this story of division into modern day times. Oh, that's right. Half the country hates the other half. You are blue or you're red, you are with us or you are enemy, you are on our side or you're not. And if you're on our side, you get all the benefits of all the doubts. And if you're on the other side, you can burn in hell. And maybe, that's a bit of a hyperbole. But I don't think I'm too far off. There are very few people on either side looking at the other and going, well, they do have a point. There's very little self-reflection. There's loads of bearing false witness and very little interpreting in the best possible light. And we're all guilty. We're all culpable. I know that I've rolled my eyes more than once the past several days. And yet, despite Jonah's hate of the Ninevites, despite his half-effort and pessimism, despite Jonah doing his very best to make sure that Nineveh burns, God works within and around Jonah's ineptitude and still accomplishes God's purposes through him. And that work isn't just to redeem Jonah, redeem the guy that's on our side, but God redeems Nineveh too. God's love doesn't pick sides. God's love crosses divides. God's love redeems us all. And maybe this story can help us put things in our current situation into perspective. In the midst of all the division in our country, from the apathy to the disdain to the hate, God can remind us again and again that God's love doesn't pick sides. They aren't as bad, and we aren't as good as the caricatures that we have in our minds. We all fall short, and yet we are all loved, redeemed, saved through a God who's got the whole world in his hands. God's love doesn't pick sides. That is a love that God shows to us, and a love that God tells us to go and share. Despite Jonah's hate for the Ninevites, God made sure that love was proclaimed. And maybe that is what God is telling us to do, too. That even if we have legitimate differences and perspectives, God still calls us to proclaim love. A love that doesn't come from political leaders or our parties. We may not like it that they are loved, too, by God, but that is what God calls us to say and to show. So how do we do that? How do we, as reluctant and angry, who show up covered in fish vomit, mumbling under our breath, how do we announce unity and love when we don't even like the people on the other side? I wish I had an answer for you. I wish I had an answer for myself. All I know is that God works despite our feelings, whether we are winners or losers, whether we are reluctant or not. Because our unity isn't in a side or in a color or in a president. Our unity is in Christ. And that may sound a little Pollyanna-ish, like our reality doesn't matter. But I don't think unity in Christ is any easier. It's actually pretty hard. It's hard because unity in Christ doesn't mean that we all win, at least not win as we think of it. Unity in Christ means that we are joined to Jesus. Unity with Christ means that we are crucified with Christ. We die. We die to ourselves, to our sinful ways, die to any other faction that we are part of. We die. We lose. Also that God can give us the win for something greater. And in that death and loss, God's redeeming love goes to work. God brings unity and life, and God will not stop. God definitely won't let our reluctance stop that love from being known. What I say today isn't going to change anybody's political mind, but that is not my job. My job is to point to a God who loves both sides, who redeems both broken sides, and who wants us to look beyond hate and disgust and pettiness to a life together that reflects and embodies what that love of God looks like. I'm to point to a love that works despite imperfect people. Remind of a love that knows for the other side. Our brokenness makes it hard to do that sometimes, but our brokenness doesn't exclude us from God's love. And it doesn't exclude them either. God has a love for us all. And maybe through this story of a big fish and a lousy prophet, we can hear and see the themes of our lives and our world and know that God is still working. God is still working to redeem us all. Amen. Just as you excelled in everything, in faith, in speech, in knowledge, in complete earnestness, and in your love for us, see that you also excel in this grace of giving. We work closely with several organizations locally and around the world. In a world of suffering, you can do a world of good. We would like to take this time to briefly highlight one of the ministries that your gifts help to support. Your financial gifts helps to make sure that we at St. Philip can make use of people's talents and worship so that we can praise God in creative and awe-inspiring ways. We do thank you for your financial support of St. Philip as we share the good news of Jesus Christ in word and in deed. You can continue your support of the mission of St. Philip as well as all of our benevolences through your regular giving. You can mail it to the church, place it in the offering basket in the back, or give online. Thank you for your continued support of St. Philip and for generously giving to these places who are God's hands and feet in Myrtle Beach and beyond.
God of all creation, all you have made is good, and your love endures forever. You bring forth bread from the earth and fruit from the vine. Nourish us with these gifts that we might be for the world signs of your gracious presence in Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
Longing for Christ's reign to come among us, we pray for the outpouring of God's power on the church, the world, and all in need. Holy Creator, surprise and delight us with the beauty of the world you have made. Bless the work of landscapers, architects, and artists, whose work invites us into harmonious living with your creation. Hear us, O God. Holy Judge, let justice roll down like waters over this world. Reign over the courtrooms of every land, in the hearts of those who guard the law, and those who stand accused of crime. Be present in cases where we long for both justice and mercy to prevail. Hear us, O God. Holy One, we pray for our country, that we may live together as one. Guide our leaders, especially President-elect Joe Biden, in your ways of peace. Though we as a people may disagree, help us to see what binds us together. Hear us, O God. Holy Protector, be with all observing Veterans Day. Guard the lives of active duty and retired military personnel. Comfort all who mourn, and we comfort all who mourn those who have died in the line of duty. Heal the wounds, both physical and mental, experienced by service members. Hear us, O God. Holy and immortal One, we pray in thanksgiving for the lives of all who have died. Remind us of the frailty and shortness of our own lives, and inspire us to use them for the building up of your kingdom. Hear us, O God. Receive our prayers in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior, until that day when you gather all creation around your throne, where you will reign forever and ever.
Amen.
Would you please stand? The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and Merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so, with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Remembering, therefore, his death, resurrection, and ascension, we await his coming in glory. Pour out upon us the spirit of your love, O Lord, and unite the wills of all who share this heavenly food, the body and blood of Jesus Christ, our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be all honor and glory.
this time, I invite you to take out your communion packet. And know that this is the body of Christ given for you and the blood of Christ shed for you. Amen. Body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace.
Amen.
Let us pray. God of abundance, with this bread of life and cup of salvation, you have united us with Christ, making us one with all your people. Now send us forth in the power of your Spirit, that we may proclaim your redeeming love to the world and continue forever in the risen life of Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Now may Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit bless you now and forever.
Amen.
Go in peace, serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.